Hi, how are you? I hope you're having a great day. Did you know that researchers have been able to detect fibromyalgia through the use of a functional MRI? According to studies, brain imaging can distinguish between fibromyalgia patients and healthy controls. But hey, we have brain abnormalities. Woohoo! Today, I'll discuss the differences between an MRI and an fMRI and the progress of brain imaging using an fMRI. Here we go. Getting an MRI, or I would imagine an fMRI, is quite expensive. But if you're questioning your diagnosis or your doctor is unsure, then it seems this might be an alternative way of discovering the truth that you have fibromyalgia. But I have no idea how insurance would cover it, or if it does, or whether you can find a neuroscientist that could read the results, or a neurotechnician who can perform it. But if you need confirmation about the area of the brain that might correlate with your symptoms, it appears that an fMRI will accomplish just that. Or perhaps you want to find out if a particular medication will work. The difference between a regular MRI and an fMRI machine is not that different, apparently. But the MRI will take pictures of what the structure of the brain looks like. For example, a 3D image. Whereas an fMRI looks at the metabolic functions of the brain, like where the brain is activating during physical sensation or activity. It's all very interesting, isn't it? In 2014, researchers found alterations between the sensory cortex and other neural systems in patients with fibromyalgia by using an fMRI machine. And also in 2014, other researchers found the brain abnormalities mediated the increased unpleasantness to visual, auditory, and tactile stimulation that are reported in our daily lives. Fibro patients need less than half the amount of pressure to get the same brain response as the control subjects did, or the healthy population. In 2017, a Colorado study used functional magnetic resonance imaging, fMRI, to measure and map the small changes in blood flow that occurred with brain activity in the cortex. fMRIs have several uses, including evaluating the effects of disease. It may detect abnormalities within the brain that can't be seen with other imaging techniques. Patients were exposed simultaneously to various non-painful visual, auditory, and tactile clues called multisensory stimulation, and separately to painful pressure. Patterns of brain activity, specifically three neurological patterns were correlated to fibromyalgia and between health controls, with a 93% success rate. They found that the non-painful stimuli were able to classify fibromyalgia patients better than the painful stimuli. They assumed that sensory amplification may be a more relevant outcome to examine the pathological factor that's driving the symptoms. For example, fibromyalgia patients express an annoyance of daily sensory signals such as noise, light, tagged on a shirt that keeps scratching your neck, and all sorts of other sensory signals. An article written about this study stated, "The potential for brain measures like the ones we developed here is that they can tell us something about the particular brain abnormalities that drive an individual's suffering. That can help us both recognize fibromyalgia for what it is, a disorder of the central nervous system, and treat it more effectively," unquote. And then also in 2017, a Michigan study subjected patients to unpleasant but non-painful visual stimulation and separately to pressure pain stimulation. They stated that the pain that we experience is spontaneous and all the time at different levels. So they found that the visual stimulation is tapping into the neural mechanisms by which fibro patients feel and experience pain. Preliminary evidence shows that fibromyalgia may be caused within the central nervous system, we already know that, right? Rather than the periphery, although we know the periphery can be involved. But periphery pain coming into the central nervous system could cause an increase in pain, such as those who have small fiber neuropathy or some other type of neuropathy. The benefits of this research are to show that fibromyalgia has an objective finding, that it is a real condition and can be treated. These are just a few of the studies. There have been many over the years. It's stated that fibromyalgia has many subgroups that fMRI might help to determine and take into consideration. For example, individuals with small fiber neuropathy. It will show differences compared to those without neuropathy. Maybe we need to be identified by our underlying pathology, not just our symptoms. And I think that's what the aim of that study was for. In April 2022, researchers did just that. As a whole, the fMRI of the fibromyalgia group showed hypoconnectivity in several brain regions. Hypoconnectivity is an underactive connectivity of blood flow. The subgroup of those with reduced skin innervation, like in neuropathy, showed hyperconnectivity of blood flow in additional brain regions, which means they also had an excess of overactivity of brain waves. The subgroups can make the findings of the research on fibromyalgia patients be just a little different. It's stated that more research on this is needed to ensure that brain imaging can produce the same results on all people with fibromyalgia. and discern between those who have a subgroup. Now, currently, we don't need an MRI or an fMRI to get diagnosed. I mean, have you ever had an MRI? Oh my gosh, it is so loud. They do give you earplugs, and maybe some locations I've heard give you headphones. I didn't get that. I don't know why. I don't know if it had to do with because I was getting a brain MRI. Don't know. It can be a little scary going into that tunnel, especially if you're claustrophobic. I mean, you can't move an inch, a speckle. They told me that if I moved, they'd have to start completely over. And the process is long and not fun. So with all of your might, you do not move. Because you want the results of that MRI, and maybe if you're getting an fMRI, to be accurate. And for your doctors to get the information they're looking for, right? But is this something that we'd want to do? I mean, I've never heard of anyone with fibromyalgia having an fMRI or MRI, unless it was to diagnose an injury or some other disease. I had to get an MRI when my eye specialist was going through the process of elimination, basically, to figure out why I lost a portion of my eyesight. But at least I learned that I don't have lesions on my brain or a tumor. So was this topic helpful? I just thought it was interesting and something I'd like to share. I hope you learned something. I send you gentle hugs and support. Love you. Oh, and one last thing. I've lost 29 pounds. I've gone down, you know, a size or two in my clothing. I feel better. I'm able to move around better, for sure. Got a little bit more to go till I'm completely happy, but I'm making my food choices not just something for the short term, but something lifelong. And that's the only way I'm going to be able to maintain the weight loss. But I just wanted to share that with you. I love you guys. Thank you so much. Have a great day. I had to get an MRI, as I said, when my eye specialist. I'm taking it slow, not